Welcome to Chapter 3. This week, we're going to talk about doing business in global markets. Business in the global market today. Over 90% of companies doing business globally believe it is important for employees to have international experience. Maybe that's why you're taking this class. U.S. organizations are also expanding abroad. There's two important definitions that we should learn, especially at this point in this chapter, is importing and exporting. I'm sure we've all heard the terms importing and exporting before, but importing is buying products from another country and bringing them in, and exporting is selling products to another country and shipping them there. In fact, the United States is the largest importer and the third largest exporting nation in the world. So, why trade with other nations? Well, countries with an abundant natural resource, like, you know, Iraq with oil or Venezuela, need technological resources from other countries like Japan or us. So basically, global trade allows countries to produce what they make best and buy what they need from others. Free trade is the movement of goods and services among nations without political and economic barriers. However, that is rarely the case. The pros and cons of free trade? Obviously, the pros are that the global market contains over 7 billion customers. Potential customers for goods and services. Productivity grows when countries produce goods and services in which they have a comparative advantage. Global competition and less costly imports keep prices down so that inflation does not hinder economic growth. Free trade inspires innovation and also new products and keeps firms competitively challenged. And it also provides, free trade also provides an uninterrupted flow of capital that gives countries access to foreign investments, which help keep bank interest rates low. Some cons, though, that comes along with free trade, domestic workers, particularly those in manufacturing-based jobs, can lose their jobs due to increased imports and production shifts to low-wage global markets. If you think about it, you've heard it all the time. I'm from Cleveland, Ohio, which was a steel town at one time. Unfortunately, in the 80s and 90s, the United States started importing their steel from China as opposed to making it and buying it within the country. Workers may be forced to accept pay cuts from employers who can threaten to move their jobs to lower-cost global markets. Some other cons are moving operations overseas because of intense competition pressure often means the loss of service jobs and growing numbers of white-collar jobs, which can lead to a mismatch in skills and jobs available. Domestic companies can lose their competitive advantage when competitors build advanced production operations in low-wage countries. This is often the case with especially clothing and different products like that. Some more ideas of why trading with other nations. The theories of comparative and absolute advantage. Now, these are important concepts to keep in mind. A comparative advantage is when a country should sell to other countries those products that it produces most efficiently, and buy from other countries those products that it cannot produce as efficiently or effectively. So a comparative advantage, that's when a country will export those products it does well, it produces well, and import those products that it does not produce well. However, an absolute advantage is when a company has a monopoly on producing a specific product or is able to produce it more efficiently than all the other countries out there. Can any of you guys think of an absolute advantage? Well, think about oil production. Most of the oil production is produced in Iraq and Iran and Saudi Arabia and Middle Eastern countries. These countries have a monopoly and formed a bloc on that they join to set oil prices. They have an absolute advantage over other countries because they have a monopoly on producing it because they have an abundance of the natural resource. So getting involved in global trade, importing goods and services. If you think about it, and if you've ever traveled abroad, you probably notice that products you're used to aren't available in other countries. By working with producers in their native countries, some become importers while still in school. Importing goods and services. Exporting provides a great boost to the U.S. economy, and it's estimated that every $1 billion in U.S. exports generates over 7,000 U.S. jobs. So exporting goods and services is a good way to get involved in the economy. It's good for the economy, and it's a good way. It's a good job. Measuring global trade. Balance of trade, the total value of a nation's exports compared to its imports over a particular period. This is the balance of trade. Exports versus imports. Trade surplus, this is a favorable metric. It occurs when the value of a country's exports exceeds that of its imports. And a trade deficit, this is unfavorable, occurs when the value of a country's imports exceeds that of its exports. And if you think about countries with a trade surplus, this would be a country like China. Whereas a trade deficit country example would be Mexico. Getting involved in global trade. The difference between money coming into a country and money leaving the country, plus money flows from other factors such as tourism, foreign aid, military, and foreign investment, is known as balance of payments. The goal is to have more money flowing into a country than out, a favorable balance. An unfavorable balance is where more money flows out of the country. Selling products in a foreign country at lower prices than those charged in the producing country can be referred to as dumping. Dumping is prohibited. However, China, Brazil, they've both been penalized for dumping steel in the United States, and much of that steel was inferior and caused a lot of problems. So, let's talk about some strategies for reaching local markets, and we're going to discuss 9 of them here. The first one is licensing, and this is going to go from easiest to hardest. Licensing is the easiest way to get involved in reaching global markets. It's a global strategy in which a firm or the licensor allows a foreign country to produce its product in exchange for a fee, often known as royalty. Licensing can benefit a firm by gaining revenues it wouldn't have otherwise generated and spending little to no money to produce or market their products. Often in a licensing agreement, the original firm or the licensor often helps them with marketing and training on how to produce the product correctly. The next easiest is exporting. Export assistance centers provide hands-on exporting assistance and trade finance support for small and medium-sized businesses that wish to directly export goods and services. And there's a lot of local business centers that can help you with that. Export trading centers can help companies engage in indirect exporting by matching buyers and sellers and dealing with foreign customs offices, documentation, and conversions. Next on the list, as we go up and get harder as far as getting active in reaching global market, is franchising. Franchising is a contractual agreement whereby somebody with a good idea for a business sells others the rights to use the name and sell a product or service in a given territory for a specified manner. Franchisers need to be careful to adapt their product to the countries they serve. Domino's Pizza and Dunkin' Donuts all adapted their products to different tapes in different countries. And if you think about it, McDonald's is another good example of this, because McDonald's has different menus for all over the world. In fact, McDonald's, if you go to England, you can often buy a beer in a McDonald's. So if we look at McDonald's English menu, let's take a look at the menu. The veggie dipper, the triple cheeseburger, a muffin with jam, Cadbury Dairy McFlurry. We got the Millionaire's Donut, Chicken Legend with barbecue, Chicken Legend with hot and spicy, the Chicken Legend with cool mayo, a side salad, the sweet chili, and obviously the Big Mac, Quarter Pounder, McChicken, Bacon Double, the Vegetable Deluxe, the Hamburger Cheeseburger. They, of course, have Chicken McNuggets and Chicken Selects, but they also have Mozzarella Dippers, which is pretty interesting. Of course, they have all the drinks available to you. Like I said, in some, they even have beer. Let's look at McDonald's in Italy. Let's take a look at the menu here. Well, they have the Grand Crispy, the Crispy McWrap, Crispy McMakin, Asiago Burger, Smoky Burger, Chicken Country, the McChicken, Double Chicken, the Filet-O-Fish, McWrap Caesar. So it's not too much different than our menu. But again, the side salad's different, and there are some different things in here, which is kind of interesting. My selection, Smoky, Chicken Country. But let's look at McDonald's in India. One thing you'll notice is that there's no meats in, or there's no meat in, ground beef. No beef in India. That's because cows are sacred. So they only have chicken. And they also have a Michelou, the kebab burger, the bean burger, and they have bowls. They have a veg burger. They have a hash brown burger, fish meal, and chicken meal, but you notice that beef is not on their menu. They have the Maharaja Mac, which is not beef, which is interesting. But again, that's based off of the fact that the cultural acceptance in that country does not allow for beef or cows to be eaten because they're sacred. So franchising is a great way somebody with a good idea can sell the rights to use a name and sell a product or service in a given territory. Contract manufacturing is a foreign company's production of private label goods to which a domestic company then attaches its own brand name or trademark. Part of the broad category of outsourcing. contract manufacturing can be used to allow a company to experiment in a new market without incurring a heavy startup cost, or temporarily meet an unexpected increase in orders. Joint ventures are partnerships in which two or more companies, often from different countries, join to undertake a major project. The benefits of joint ventures: you share your technology and risk, you share marketing and management expertise, and the entry into markets where foreign companies are often not allowed unless goods are produced locally. Strategic alliances are long-term partnerships between two or more companies established to help each company build a competitive market advantage. Now, they don't typically share costs, risks, management, or profits. And strategic alliances provide broad access to markets, capital, and technical expertise. Foreign direct investments, FDIs, are the buying of permanent property and businesses in foreign nations. This is, again, on the harder end of getting active in a global market. A foreign subsidiary is a company owned in a foreign country by another company called the parent company. The primary advantage to this is the parent company maintains complete control over its technology or expertise, but the disadvantage, it must commit funds and technology within foreign boundaries. And if you think about car companies, this happens a lot. In fact, Jeep is a foreign subsidiary of Fiat, which is an Italian-owned automobile. A multinational corporation is an organization that manufactures and markets products in many different countries that has a multinational stock ownership and multinational management. Not all large global businesses are multinational. Only firms that have manufacturing capacity or some other physical presence in different nations can truly be multinational. An example of this would be Fujifilm. Fuji produces cameras in many nations, and it markets products in different countries and have stock ownership and multinational management. In fact, my marketing firm deals with Fujifilm Australia. Some forces affecting trading in global markets. Sociocultural forces can have an effect on global markets. To be involved in a global trade, you must be aware of the cultural differences among nations. And we talked about this with that McDonald's example. You need to be understanding of the social structures, the religion, the manners and customs, the values and attitudes, the language, and the personal communication of the country that you're active in. It's important that you alter your product. For example, here's some examples of companies that did not take those into consideration with some marketing and products. Coors Beer put its slogan "Turn It Loose" into Spanish and found it translated as "Suffer from diarrhea." Not a good tagline to make you want to drink beer. Purdue Chicken used the slogan, "It takes a strong man to make a chicken tender," which was interpreted in Spanish as "It takes an aroused man to make a chicken affectionate." There's other glitches. KFC finger licking good was understood in Japanese as "bite your fingers off." PepsiCo attempted a Chinese translation of "Come Alive, You're in the Pepsi Generation" that read in Chinese as "Pepsi brings your ancestors back from the dead." So again, it's important that you know, especially when you're talking about language, what you're getting yourself into. Some economic and financial forces that you need to deal with when trading in a global market is exchange rate, the value of one current nation's currency relative to the currencies of other countries. High value of the dollar is when the dollar is trading for more foreign currency and foreign products become cheaper. the low value of the dollar, the dollar is trading for less foreign currency, foreign goods become more expensive. So if you open up your internet browser and go to Google, foreign exchange rate, you can play around and see which currency is actually worth more than the US dollar. For this example, the euro is worth 84 cents to our dollar. Whereas the, let's take a look at the Great Britain pound. It's around 78 cents. What about the Canadian dollar? Let's take a look at the Canadian dollar. The Canadian dollar is actually worth more than it's worth less. So for every dollar, you get $1.32. If you look at, again, the pound, you only get 74 cents on the dollar. The pound is actually worth more than our dollar. One US dollar equals 78 pounds sterling. So again, it depends on the individual country, but Google foreign exchange rate and take a look at different countries. How about the Jamaican dollar? Let's see what the Jamaican dollar looks like. Whew! One US dollar equals 143 Jamaican dollars. So as you can tell, the Jamaican dollar is not as valuable as the US dollar. What about the Mexican peso? The Mexican peso is $21. One US dollar equals 21 Mexican dollars. So as you can see, when you're dealing with global economies, the low value of the dollar or the high value of the dollar can make products cheaper or more expensive. And currencies float in value depending on the supply and demand for them in global markets. This is referred to as a floating exchange rate. Some other forces: devaluation, the lowering value of a nation's currency in relative to other currencies. For instance, a few years ago, Greece was having a lot of problem and their currency was devaluing. Counter trading is a complex form of bartering in which several countries may be involved, each trading goods for services or other goods or services. Legal and regulatory forces have an effect on global markets. There's no global system of laws. Each country has its own set of laws, and these may be inconsistent. However, U.S. businesses must follow U.S. laws while conducting U.S. Global business. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, and Transparency International fight to end corruption and bribery in foreign markets that have had little success. Some physical and environmental factors that affect global markets. Developing countries have transportation and storage systems that make international distribution difficult or impossible. Often, technological capabilities are far from those in the U.S., which makes it a tough business environment. So think about those third world countries. Obviously, or developing countries, as your homework assignment will talk about. Developing countries have a lot of barriers facing them. And it's important to understand those barriers when you're dealing with a foreign country. For instance, if we're dealing with a country in the Southern Caribbean, and like St. Lucia. St. Lucia has a low GDP. Their main source of income is tourism. It's a developing country and it has a lot of transportation issues that make it difficult for international distribution. In fact, they very rarely trade with anybody outside of those around them. Technological capabilities are very low there too, so it makes it very difficult for them to compete. And that's why their GDP is so low, because they have a lot of barriers facing them. Trade protectionism is the use of government regulations to limit the import of goods and services. Advocates of protectionism believe that allows domestic producers to survive, grow, and produce jobs. Tariffs, and I'm sure you've heard that, is a tax imposed on imports. There are protective tariffs, and there's also revenue tariffs. Import quotas are a limit on the number of products in certain categories that a nation can import. And an embargo is a complete ban on the import or export of a certain product, or the stopping of all trade with a particular country. The biggest, the most popular example of this is the U.S. embargo against Cuba. And we're loosening that embargo, and we're actually opening up trade with Cuba, as well as tourism into Cuba for the first time since the early 1960s. The WTO, or the World Trade Organization, helps establish rules and agreements between international countries. The General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade is a 1948 agreement that established an international forum for negotiating mutual reductions in trade restrictions. The WTO is a 164 member nation group whose purpose is to oversee cross-border trade issues and global business practices. It's headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland. Common markets. Common markets are regional groups of countries that have a common external tariff, no internal tariffs, and a coordination of laws to facilitate exchange called the trading bloc. These are when a group of countries, usually that are touching each other, get together and actually create a common market. The most popular example of that is the EU, or European Union. As you know, the European Union, England is leaving the European Union. It's called Brexit. So there's a lot of worry that the European Union will not survive Britain leaving it. There's some North American and Central American groups, common markets. The NAFTA, or North American Free Trade Agreement, is an agreement that created a free trade area among the U.S., Canada, and Mexico back in 1994. Obviously, President Trump has pulled out of NAFTA, nullifying this. The Central American Free Trade Agreement, or CAFTA, is an agreement that created a free trade zone with Costa Rica, Dominican Republic, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua. This was signed into law in 2005 and still exists today. North American Trade Agreement, NAFTA, the objectives were to eliminate trade barriers and facilitate cross-border movement of goods and services. Also to promote the conditions of fair competition, increase investment opportunities, and provide effective protection and enforcement of intellectual property rights, patents, and copyrights. It also established a framework for further regional trade cooperation and improved working conditions across North America. However, President Trump did not, and members of Congress did not feel that it was fair enough for the United States, so that's why they exited NAFTA. So that's it on chapter three, doing business in the global market. Let's talk for a second about your homework assignment. Your homework assignment is to read chapter three and also participate in the discussion. The discussion is, we all use products from across the globe. However, sometimes we're surprised to find that one of our favorite products is actually imported from another country. So I'd like for your attendance for this week, as proof of attendance, is to give me an example of the product you use and love that is actually from another country. Tell me that about the product and give me its origin. The other thing I'd like you to do is to complete the homework assignment. And the homework assignment is talking about industrialized and developing nations. We talked about how industrial nations like the United States have a high standard of living. There's also countries with a lower standard of living and quality of life called developing countries. And I think in our talk, we talked about St. Lucia. So your assignment is to identify one of each and describe what factors cause it to either be an industrialized nation or what factors are preventing the developing country from reaching that status. So in the United States, why is it an industrialized nation? Well, it is one of the biggest importers and exporters in the world. Technology is far advanced. Transportation is very good. Our rail systems are great. We have airports all over the country. And an example of St. Lucia as a developing country from reaching that status, it's too small. It's a small island. It's mostly an agricultural country that needs to advance technology and also in transportation and being able to reach other countries. So as you can see, I just identified two countries and did the homework assignment. Please don't use the U.S. or St. Lucia since I did this. But I'd like you to describe both of these and do this in a paragraph or two in each country and have this be around one page in length. Well, that's it. Good luck with your homework, and we'll talk again next week.